All right, guys, today we're going to look at the Sui Dynasty. So after the fall of the Han Dynasty in China, you have the Sui Dynasty, who kind of comes in and reunifies China. But it took 4 centuries before the Sui Dynasty came about and before China was ever united again. So leading up to the Sui Dynasty, you have this long time period of wars and political unrest. Basically, everybody trying to gain more power and try to rule China. So we're going to take a minute here and walk through the do now that you had for the Sui Dynasty. So it talks about the chaos that happened after the fall of the Han Dynasty, and then it goes into what characterized that time, what happened when the Sui Dynasty came into the scene, kind of what went on during the Sui Dynasty, and then it talks about the fall of the Sui Dynasty. So you should have all read that either in your virtual class or in your paper packets. So we're going to take a moment and actually go through the questions on that do now, just to make sure that everybody was on the same page with those. So number one says, define unified in your own words. So I took some of the answers that were most common within the classes and put that here for you. To be joined together or working toward a similar goal. Typically when we think of unified or someone being united, that's what we're talking about. So number two says, describe what characterized China for 4 centuries after the fall of the Han Dynasty. Got that highlighted in yellow for you. So warring clans, political murders, and foreign invaders characterized the next 4 centuries, talking about the 4 centuries following the Han Dynasty. So we talked about in class how warring clans, political murders, and foreign invaders doesn't really describe the type of place where I personally would want to live. And I doubt many of you would want to live there either. You've got all these different clans or groups of people who are fighting against each other, trying to expand their territory, trying to gain more power within China. And that lasted for 4 centuries. So then there are 3 different kingdoms. We don't really call them dynasties in the same context that we look at our other dynasties, simply because they never really ruled all of China. There was so much unrest. So number 3 says to list the different kingdoms of China and describe how China was set up following the fall of the Han Dynasty. So I have those highlighted in green. You have the 3 kingdoms from 220 to 280, the Western and Eastern Jin Empire, which was from 265 to 420, and then you have the Northern and Southern dynasties from 420 to 588. So during that time, as far as the setup of China, you didn't have much stability. I mean, you have the 3 kingdoms for a 60-year period, and then you have the Western and Eastern, and then the Northern and Southern dynasties, but you don't have anybody ruling all of China. They're just ruling over certain areas. You have a lot of clashes between different groups trying to gain power. So the next dynasty that actually unifies China brings us to number 4, which says identify when China was united again after the fall of the Han Dynasty. This one will be in blue. It says the feuding clans of China were finally united once again in 589 CE, or Common Era, by Wen Ti and the Sui Dynasty. So the Sui Dynasty comes onto the scene and reunifies China, brings them all together, has people working towards a similar purpose, a similar goal within China. Now, as we're going to see as we go through this, the way that the Sui Dynasty unified China may not have been the best way to unify the people. And you'll see that when we get to the end of the Sui Dynasty and find out that the Sui Dynasty ends because of the people losing faith in the government and revolting against them. But they did have some achievements. So number five says, list some of the achievements of the Sui Dynasty. So we'll do that now. I'll have those in purple for you. The Sui Dynasty accomplished great feats, including another restoration of the Great Wall of China and the construction of the Great Canal linking the eastern plains to the northern rivers. So those, along with unifying China, are some pretty significant achievements. But then we get to number six, and it says, explain what led to the downfall and decline of the Sui Dynasty. We'll go to the end of that last paragraph there, and I have that highlighted for you in red. The Sui taxed peasants heavily. So your lower class people had very high taxes, and they forced them into hard labor, which is where they got their workforce for the restoration of the Great Wall, the construction of the Great Canal, things of that nature. And when you have these people all working together, even if it's by force, that helps with your unity, because now these people are working. You're telling them this is what you're going to do. They don't have time to go out and fight to try to gain power or gain authority. But at the same time, you still have your lower class people, your peasants, your working class, who are being forced into labor, and that doesn't sit very well with them. So the Sui Dynasty eventually became weak after they had heavy losses in fighting against Korea. And then the Sui Dynasty fell apart because the people, the same people that they're forcing into labor, the same people that they have just unified, lose faith in their government, lose faith in the Sui Dynasty, and revolt. And that brings us to the end of the Sui Dynasty. So our highlights of the Sui Dynasty are that they were able to restore the Great Wall. They constructed the Great Canal. They unified China, which basically, in this particular case, pretty much just means that they put them under one emperor, one ruler. But another thing that they did was that they used Buddhism. The emperors of the Sui Dynasty used Buddhism to justify their conquests of other places. And Buddhism really took hold in China and impacted the lives of the people in China pretty significantly. So we're going to take just a moment to look at what is Buddhism. Just very brief, very simple. Buddhism teaches ways to escape suffering in life and ways to find inner peace, which is called nirvana. So after this period of disunion, after the fall of the Han Dynasty, when you had all this absolute chaos in China, and you had violence and political murders and constant warring between clans, the people wanted a way to find peace. They had been suffering. They're suffering even more under the Sui Dynasty in the fact that they're being forced into this hard labor. So their suffering continues. And these ideas in Buddhism teach them ways to escape suffering and life. Specifically talks about suffering being caused by a want for material things. We'll go to another document here for just a moment, and I'll show you the teachings of Buddhism that we have listed in another assignment from class. It teaches suffering is a part of life. The reason people suffer is because they want too many material possessions. And then by living a wise and moral life, people can learn to escape suffering and find that inner peace. And all of this appealed to the people who have lived through these warring times, to the people who were living in the Sui Dynasty. They see a way to deal with and maybe even escape their sufferings. And to them, that was pretty significant. So the fall of the Sui opens the doors for a new empire, a new dynasty to take hold in China. So the next video and the next lesson that we will have in class is going to talk about the dynasties that come in and take over after the fall of the Sui in China. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out. I'll help you in any way that I can. And make sure, whether you're paper and pencil or virtual at this time, that you're getting your assignments turned in. We do have progress reports coming up, so let's get all of that turned in so that I can get grades in. And I will see you guys later.